right, if you would, take your Bible, turn to 1 Peter chapter number 4. 1 Peter chapter number 4. And over the past few weeks, we've been discussing spiritual gifts. And I want us to understand this. I want us to grasp this. Because as you go into 1 Corinthians, the Bible tells us that the Lord gives all of us gifts, and that everybody in the church is important. But at the same token, as He gives us these gifts and everybody is important, God expects us to use the gift that He gives us. Where does He expect us to use that gift? Inside the local New Testament church. Okay? I want to begin in 1 Peter chapter number 4, and I want to read two verses tonight. One is in verse number 10. But I want to begin in verse number 9 because I think it's the crutch here of everything, where it says, use hospitality to one to another. Without what? Without grudging. The term means murmuring, complaining over everything that He's done for us and given to us, as every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another, as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God, or the word of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth, that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Why were these gifts given? Why were gifts given to us? Anybody? We're going to preach tonight. To minister to one another, but the ultimate goal, Brother Terry, was that glory would be given to God. As you go through and you study the book of 1 Corinthians, you're going to notice that he told the church of Corinth that they shouldn't think more highly of themselves than they ought to think. Why did he make that statement to them? Because there were those that were using some of their spiritual gifts as being puffed up in themselves, and instead of using that spiritual gift to benefit the whole church and to benefit individuals, they were just using their spiritual gift to make themselves look good. But the fact of the matter is that spiritual gifts were never given to the church or individuals to make an individual look good. They were given so that God might be glorified in what they do and in the church. That's why they were given. He says, when you use this gift, use hospitality. Do not abuse the gift that's given to you. Don't do it grudgingly, and don't murmur and complain about things. He says you need to use it to bring honor and glory to God Almighty. That's why He gave it to us. That's why everybody in this church has a spiritual gift that is to be used inside of the local church. We studied last week and we dealt with the fact of how the Holy Spirit gives us the gifts. Because if you go back over into 1 Corinthians chapter 12 or you go over into Romans chapter 12, you'll learn that these gifts are given by the Holy Spirit for the pleasure of Almighty God. So we've learned over the weeks that we all have this ministry. Everybody in this church has a ministry. Everybody's important. The problem is that just like the church of Corinth, we may think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think, and then we start abusing the gift, and in turn begin to abuse other people, thinking that we have arrived. We can't do that. Because he says that we're to, what? Think on another's wealth, not of ourselves. not about ourselves. What can I do to benefit the other individual? How is this going to bring honor and glory to God? How is this going to help me spiritually? How is this going to advance the cause of Christ? How is this going to see people saved and lives changed? That's why we were even left here to begin with. If not, after once we accepted Christ as Savior, He might as well have taken us out. But there's a reason He left us here. There's a reason that He gave us the gifts. And see, that person, each person is expected to fulfill their gift inside the church. But we need to be careful not to abuse it. And that our gift is to be understood and known. Go over to 1 Corinthians chapter number 12. 1 Corinthians chapter number 12. And he's going to start naming off gifts. Now, here's what I want to ask. Does a lost person understand what gifts are? Are they ever going to be able to understand what gifts are? Why is that? Because the natural man, the lost man, doesn't understand the Scriptures. The lost man doesn't understand the principles and precepts of the Word of God. The lost man doesn't understand how to do decent things decently and in order. They don't understand those things. If you go over into 1 Corinthians chapter number 2 and verse number 12, he goes through and he starts mentioning some things. He says, now we have received not the spirit of the world. When we accepted Christ as personal Savior, did we receive the spirit of the world? No. He said, we receive the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. Does God want to keep everything a secret from us? He wants us to know what the Word of God is. He wants us to be able to discern. He wants us to take these things that He's given us and apply them to our hearts and lives that we might be better servants for Him and that He might use us for the cause of Christ. Now, as I mentioned before, there are three categories if you go into the gifts. One is the category of motivation. Motivational gifts. That list is given to us in the book of Romans, chapter number 12. And as you go to chapter number 12, I want to read verse number 3 through verse number 9. Paul has just now begged the Romans. He has begged them to be not conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of their mind. Verse number 1 and verse number 2. And then in verse number 3, he begins to talk about how they are to love in their service to all men. Now, do we love everybody? That was weak. Do we love everybody? Now, there is a big difference here. I have the responsibility as a child of God to love everybody. Don't you? But there are times I may not like you. There might be times you don't like me. You still got to love me. Why? Because that's what Scripture says. Because He says if you don't love your brother, woo, you're in trouble. If you don't love your own, if you don't love your brother and sister in Christ, you got a problem. You got a spiritual problem, according to 1 John. But see, the thing is, though, as he goes through in the Romans and he's telling them, he is speaking about how they are supposed to, of that grace that was given to them, not to think, verse number 3, not to think of themselves more highly than they ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, does Serenity Baptist Church have many members in one body? Okay, keep that thought. And all members have not the same office. Does everybody in here have the same office? No. Have you ever been around a place where there's more chiefs than there are Indians? What do you have? Chaos. It's called the government. I didn't say that. We're being recorded, matter of fact. So the thing is, though, is that there is a proper order in leadership. We're learning that in Sunday school, according to 1 Timothy. Here he's trying to do the very same thing with the rank and file when it goes to ministry inside the church. He's already dealt with the fact over in 1 Corinthians chapter number 12 that not everybody can be the head, and not everybody can be the feet, and not everybody can be the hands, and not everybody can be the arms and the legs. Not everybody can be an eyeball. Could you imagine if everybody were the eyeballs? That's how Paul addressed it with the church of Corinth. In Romans, he's addressing about the same thing because not everyone has the same office. So we being many are one body in Christ and every one members one of another. So even though we might be many, we make up one body called the Serenity Baptist Church. Okay? Verse 6. Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, and now he starts the list. Okay? Whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith. Or ministry, let us wait on our ministering. Or he that teacheth on teaching. Or he that exhorteth on exhortation. He that giveth, let him do it with simplicity. He that ruleth with diligence. He that showeth mercy with cheerfulness. Let love be without dissimulation. The term means hypocrisy. Let love be without hypocrisy. Okay? Abhor that which is evil. Cleave or hold fast to that which is good. Be kindly affectionate one to another with brotherly love and honor, preferring one another. Not slothful in business, fervent in spirit. Why? Because it's all about doing one thing. Serving the Lord. Rejoicing in hope. Patient in tribulation. Continuing instant in prayer. Distributing to the necessity or the needs of the saints. And given to hospitality. So he goes through and he starts naming these motivational gifts. These gifts, listen real quick. These gifts are gifts that we are responsible in developing. Now what happens to a gift if we have it and we do not use it? We begin to lose it. I used to play a trumpet and a baritone horn. Don't try to give me one now because it will sound like a moose is lost in the wilderness. Because I haven't played one since college. But you give Durrell's son a trumpet, he can flat play that thing. You put our ladies at the piano, they know what they're doing. Okay? But it takes practice in order to keep that up. there are some things in our spiritual gift, especially when it comes to motivation, that we need to use all the time lest we lose it. Let me give you an example. My grandpa was a gentle man. But the older he got, the more cantankerous he became. I don't know if she's talking about me now or... because I don't think you met my grandparents, except for my grandmother. So, but what happened was, is that it's like anything else. That hospitality, that gentleness, over a period of time, if it's not put into operation and it's not putting into use, what happens to it? It begins to fade. There are certain gifts that are given that God gives them to us, and He says, here's a gift, develop it and use it. Okay? Our problem is a lot of times we don't take the time to develop it. So what happens is we begin to lose the gift. There are other gifts that are called ministry gifts. Over in 1 Corinthians chapter number 12, if you were to go and read ministry gifts in verse number 27 through verse number 31, that the Lord has placed certain people inside the church that are ministry gifts. Now, let me say this. Some people want all the ministry gifts, but they don't want the behind-the-scenes gifts. Do you know why? People like to be noticed. But the behind-the-scenes gifts are there to assist in ministry, just like the motivational gifts are. But in verse 27, he says, now ye are the body of Christ and members in particular. And God has set some in the church. First, apostles. Secondarily, prophets. Thirdly, teachers. After that, miracles. Then gifts of healings, helps, governments, diversity of tongues. But then he asked the question in verse number 29. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Are all workers of miracles? Have all the gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? But covet earnestly the best gifts. And yet show I unto you a more or a zealous excellent way. Now let me ask you this. What gifts did the folks of the church of Corinth want? Did they want the behind the scenes gifts? They wanted the gifts that brought light to them. Not necessarily using them for the benefit of everyone. Now, let me make this statement. Some of the gifts that we will read and put into context are not in operation today. They were temporary gifts. Why were those gifts temporary? Anybody? They were transitional. They didn't have the completed word of scripture at the time. Okay? These gifts were given to show whom they were following. Did Jesus have to prove himself? Yes. I mean, he didn't have to because he was the Son of God. But at the same token, he gave some gifts to the apostles so that people watching, when they say, I'm a follower of Christ, and he is the Messiah, and he's given us this special gift in order to prove who he is. As a certain individual, would they automatically have that power? No. Okay, where'd power come from? That they could heal. Where did the power come that they could raise someone from the dead? Where did that power come from? Did they say, oh, you know, could they have sat back and said, oh, do you see who I am? I got this ability. No, every bit of it was to point to Jesus Christ. Do you know that the gifts that are still in operation today should do the very same thing? But there are some gifts that were just temporary that are now removed, that are not used. There are those that believe in apostolic succession today, that they can still do the very same things now, that there are men today that can do the very same things the apostles did when Jesus walked on earth. Can't happen. Can I heal somebody? I'm the pastor of Serenity Baptist Church. Can I heal somebody? No. But I know who can. So we've got to be careful with these gifts that they're utilized in the proper fashion and they're performed the proper way for the edifying of the church, and that Christ is recognized and God is glorified through it all. So we have gifts that are motivational gifts. We have gifts that are ministry gifts. And then we have manifestation gifts. Look at chapter 12, verse number 7 through 11. Okay? But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to what? Profit withal. For to one he giveth by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another the gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another divers kinds of tongues, and to another the interpretation of tongues. But all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally, or assigning to every man individually as he will. Now, how do we use these gifts? Now, I've asked a question over the past couple weeks. How many of you know what your spiritual gift is? And very few hands have gone up. Okay? Now, let me ask this. How many people in this room tonight, this is the first time you've ever heard anything or learned anything about spiritual gifts? Okay. My next question would be, if you've learned something before about your spiritual gift, why don't you know what it is? That's not a put-down question. That's a thinking question. Why don't I know what it is? Many people inside the church don't even seek out what their spiritual gift is. And the reason is that if I know what my gift is, I'm going to be required to use it. Well, he's given you a gift, you're still required to use it. It doesn't matter whether I seek it out or not. I'm still required to utilize it and use it. Charlie?
I think mine is to visit the sick,
Okay? See, in doing so, though, you fit in the list somewhere here that is given. Because if you were to take and divide these out, you would notice that motivational gifts have to do with prophecy and serving and teaching and exhortation and giving and organization and mercy. That ministry gifts have to do with apostleship, missionary sent forth, prophets, teachers, miracles, healing, helping, government oversight, and language or tongues. That manifestation gifts have to do with words of wisdom, with words of knowledge, with faith, visualizing, and with the gift of healing and prophecies and discerning of spirits and various tongues and interpretation of tongues. Now, did you notice something? Some of these overlap. Some of these overlap. Can I say that when you have a gift over here, it may be operational not only in motivation, it might be a gift that is also operational over in ministry or over in manifestation. Because they overlap. And see, you have to begin to learn how that does overlap. Now, let me say this. By knowing this, there are results of those manifestations. Okay, let me give you an example. Let's say that I go over in motivational gifts and I look at exhorting. Okay? Sunday school teachers, those of you that are in here, you would fall in under an exhorter. You would fall in under exhorter because you want to exhort the kids to follow the Word of God, correct? Right? That's why it's very important that Sunday school teachers are faithful, that they come to Wednesday nights and Sunday mornings and Sunday school, because there are things that they're going to teach the kids. How can we teach the kids something if we're not doing what we're supposed to be in the first place? Correct? So that would fall in under an exhorter. So you suppose that this exhorter is a Sunday school teacher and the lesson that week is on removing guilt from your life. And you motivate the kids in the class or someone in the class, you motivate to help that member clear their conscience and to grow spiritually. That's a good idea, isn't it? Well, if you go over into ministry, teachers, that is assigned to that class, would be then be using their gift in teaching. So in one way, you use your gift of teaching in ministry, but you're a motivation to someone over in a motivational gift. And then what do you teach them? Let me say this. When you take these gifts and you lay them out, everyone that has a different gift in here will look at what is being taught differently. What? I want us to understand this. Let's say that somebody in your home drops a dessert plate and it makes a big mess in the house. How do you think a prophet would see that? Anybody? Do what? The person that has the gift of being a prophet would say, this is what happens when you're not careful. The person that has the gift of serving would say, oh, let me help you clean that up. The person that is the teacher would say, the reason that it fell is that it was too heavy on one side and there became lopsided and fell off the table. The exhorter would say, next time, let's serve the dessert with the meal and let's be prepared for it before it happens. The giver would say, I'll be happy to get you a new dessert. The organizer would say, would you get the mop and would you help us clean this up? Would you fix another dessert for this individual and start giving directions to help get the thing taken care of? The person that has the gift of mercy would say, don't feel badly. It could happen to any one of us. Do you see the differences in each one of those gifts? That's exactly what happens inside of a church. Let's go over to another thought process. Let's see how Christians would respond to something. Okay? Let's say they're going to start a church. They're going to organize a brand new church. And I'm sure that when this church was organized and it was brought to pass, that the ideas of the people that gathered, all of them, had different thoughts of everything. Just like today. The prophet would say, what we need is well-prepared sermons exposing sin and proclaiming the righteousness of God and warning of judgment to come. Is there anything wrong with that? Is there anything wrong with that? No. The server would say, what we need is practical assistance to the members of the church in order to encourage them and to help them fulfill their responsibilities. Is there anything wrong with that? The teacher would say, what we need as we start this church is in-depth Bible studies with special emphasis on the precise meaning of words. Anything wrong with that? The exhorter would say, personal counseling and encouragement for members in order to assist them in applying scriptural principles to daily living. Nothing wrong with that one either. Huh? But all of them put together should, Brother Mike. But the thing is, though, the prophet's saying that we expose sin and we proclaim righteousness and of judgment to come. The server says that we need to encourage them and help them fulfill their responsibilities inside the church. Everything that has been said really points at people to the Lord. The giver, we need to have generous programs of financial assistance to missionaries and other ministries. The organizer says smooth running organization throughout the church so that every phase will be carried out decently and in order. The gift of mercy says special outreach and concern for the precise and varying feelings of individuals with a readiness to meet their spiritual needs. There's nothing wrong with any of these. Because each one of those gifts should be pointing people to Christ and bringing glory to Almighty God. Let's take it to another level. Years ago, I had a young man when I started the... He is now a retired full-blown colonel from the Air Force. We will see him in a few weeks. He was one of the first folks that joined the church down in Columbus, Mississippi. He was in the Air Force. He was a training pilot on the Tweeds, the T-37s, and 38s. Russ did not have... Russ did not have the gift of mercy. That was not his gift. He went on some visits with me, and I'd go to the hospital, and they'd say, "Preacher, could you pray for me? I've got this, that, or the other." And his question would be, "You're diabetic." "Yeah. So what are you eating?" "Can't breathe." "So did you smoke?" And he would go into a room and he'd go, "Man, you look terrible. What happened to you?" And I told Russ one day, I said, "Russ, preacher, I'm just telling them the truth." I said, "That's not it, man. You got to have some tact in the process. Your gift is not mercy. I'll tell you that right now. So if you take a spiritual gifts test, just leave that page off, because you're either going to lie on it, but your gift's not mercy." Well, they wanted me to pray for it, but they did nothing about taking care of them being diabetic or emphysema or whatever. I said, "That's between them and the Lord. I'm just going to pray that the Lord give them discernment to take care of themselves." "Oh, is that what I'm supposed to do?" So, here's another scenario. You have a group of Christians. They're standing in a hospital and they're visiting somebody that is sick. It's these same folks: the prophet, the server, the teacher, the exhorter, the giver, the organizer, and the one that has mercy. Do you think all of them are going to have a different outlook on this hospital call? The prophet's going to say, "Have you thought about what God is trying to say to you through this? Is there some sin that you haven't confessed? Is there something going on that God's trying to show you?" The server might say, "Here's a little gift. And I brought your mail from the house. I fed your dog. I watered your plants. And I washed all your dishes and cleaned your car." The teacher would say something like, "I did some research on your illness, and I believe I can explain what's going on because I Googled it." The exhorter might say, "How can we use what you're learning here to help with others in the future?" The giver would say, "Do you have any insurance to cover this illness?" The organizer would say, "Don't worry about a thing. I've assigned your job to 4 other people in the office to carry it all out." The one that has mercy would say, "I can't begin to tell you how I felt when I learned you were sick. How do you feel now?" Remember that many of these gifts overlap. Let me make this statement and we'll pick it up here next time. Is that every one of us with different spiritual gifts are going to look at a situation a different way. As long as it coincides with the Word of God, there's not a problem. Did you catch what I just said? As long as it coincides with the Word of God, there's not a problem. The problem is like with the Church of Corinth, where they wanted the most excellent gifts so that they could shine to make everybody else look bad. Okay? A lot of times when I've had people come up and say, did somebody tell you what I did? No. And then they'll go on to say, somebody told you what I did. God uses the prophet, the organizer, the server. He uses all of these individuals. But I'm going to say this. Everyone in this room, when the word goes out, is going to have a different opinion on how you're going to let it apply to you. If I say, thus saith the Lord, the person that doesn't have the gift of prophecy is not going to accept it the same way the person that has the gift of prophecy. Same thing with the server. Same thing with the organizer. Why? Because our natural thinking sometimes skews our thoughts of our gifts. Okay? And we'll pick it up here next time. Isn't that interesting? Everyone will see it a different way. It doesn't mean that it's necessarily wrong. It's that we have to put everything into perspective.